Good evening. Good evening. No, is it working? Yeah. Okay. So I'm the reading series coordinator for the Writer Studio, and before we begin, I would like to thank the Strand Bookstore, especially Emily, who has helped make tonight's event possible. Today, the Writer Studio is very proud to celebrate the release of Philip Schultz's novel in verse, The Wherewithal, published by Norton. Michael Dickman is joining Philip Schultz for this reading and will be our first reader. And the reading will be followed by a book signing and a small reception, and the books are for sale on the table or the cart behind you. A quick word about the Writer Studio, which is hosting this event. We are a 28 years old independent writing school, which offers ongoing 10-week fiction and poetry workshops for beginners and more seasoned writers in New York City, San Francisco, Tucson, Arizona, and Amsterdam in the Netherlands. We also have a Kids Write program, which offers free creative writing workshops to high school students in Brooklyn. And to find out more about our workshops, method, or classes, you can go to the website www.writerstudio.com. That's Writer Studio with one S. If you know anybody who you think might benefit from our class, please take the time to tell them. We get very high quality students through word of mouth, and we really appreciate your effort in spreading the word. Our last reading of the season will be on April 26th and will feature faculty members and masterclass students from the New York City program. Michael Dickman is the author of The End of the West and the co-author of the 50 American plays, Boss from Cooper Canyon Press. His second collection of poetry, Flies, also from Cooper Canyon Press, received the James Laughlin Award, and he was awarded also the Order Fellowship from Princeton University. Please welcome Michael.
Good evening. Good evening. Isn't that nice? Okay. Thanks for coming out tonight. It's really exciting to get to read here. You know, I grew up in the Pacific Northwest, in the poetry section of a bookstore. Should I put it up a little like this? Good evening. It's good to see it. Thanks, Anne. As I was saying, that's what, Harpo Marx, that's what he said once. He hadn't like said anything in any movie or like spoken, given in any interviews. And then at some point on stage, he was accepting an award and he came out and there was a microphone and he said, as I was saying, I always thought that was so great. I grew up in the poetry section of a bookstore called Powell's Books, which is the best bookstore in the country. But I'm so excited to be here at the Strand. I'm so excited to be here at the Strand reading. I've spent so much time here, so I'll read you some poems from both The End of the West and Flies, and then a couple new poems about animals. So, we did not make ourselves. We did not make ourselves is one thing I keep singing into my hands while falling asleep. For just a second, before I have to get up and turn on all the lights in the house, one after the other, like opening an advent calendar. My brain opening, the chemical miracles in my brain switching on. I can hear dogs barking, some trees, last stars. You think you'll be missed, It won't last long, I promise. I'm not dead, but I am standing very still in the backyard, staring up at the maple 30 years ago, a tiny kid waiting on the ground, alone in heaven, in the world, in white sneakers. I'm having a good time humming along to everything I can still remember back there. How we're born, made to look up at everything we didn't make. We didn't make grass, mosquitoes, or breast cancer. We didn't make yellow jackets or sunlight either. I didn't make my brain, but I'm helping to finish it. Carefully stacking up everything I made next to everything I ruined in broad daylight, in bright brain light. This morning I killed a fly and didn't lie down next to the body as we're supposed to. We're supposed to. Soon I'm going to wake up. Dogs, trees, stars. There is only this world and this world. What a relief. Created over and over.
This next poem, I wanted to read because we're in a bookstore and it sort of comes from reading books. It's called From the Lives of My Friends, and it's I wrote it partly because of reading short stories and plays by Anton Chekhov, who, do you know Anton? He was a Russian guy. And a doctor. Like if you had a fever and you lived in the right town, Anton Chekhov would be your doctor. But he had notes to write a novel. And the novel was supposed to be called Stories from the Lives of My Friends. And he never wrote that novel. And I thought, well, that's a great title. And so I stole part of that. And then the only other thing to know, you know, poets a lot, well, they'll tell you, like, you need to know some things, or you'll remember, like, Homer went on a trip, I'm not very good at that. But I'll just say that when Chekhov died, his body was shipped back to Moscow in a refrigerated car that said oysters on the outside. And I thought, that is the way to go. Especially having lived up, you know, grown up in Oregon, I thought, like, my refrigerator, I'd be dead, and the refrigerator car would say, oysters, and then beneath it would say, and IPA. And it would just, you know, that seems great. From the Lives of My Friends. What are the birds called in that neighborhood? The dogs. There were dogs flying from branch to branch. My friends and I climbed up the telephone poles to sit on the power lines, dressed like crows. Their voices sounded like lemons. They were a smooth sheet. They grew black feathers. Not frightening at all, but beautiful, shiny, and full of promise. What kind of light is that? The lives of my friends spend all of their time dying and coming back and dying and coming back. They take a break in summer to mow the piss yellow lawns, blazing front and back. There is no break in winter. I fell in love with the sisters of my friends. All that yellow hair. Their arms blazing. They lick their fingers to wipe my face clean of everything and I am glad. I am glad. I am so glad. We will all be shipped away in an icebox with the one word oysters painted on the outside. Left alone for once. None of my friends wrote novels or plays. From the lives of my friends came their lives. Here's what we did. We played in the yard outside after dinner, and then we were shipped away. That was fast, stuffed with lemons. This book flies. A lot of it is made up of elegies that I wrote for my older brother when he passed away. Before my older brother died, his name is Darren, and but before he died, I have these now. These elegies came from dreams that I had, I guess I'm trying to say. And my dreams before Darren died were always very boring in general, and they are now, at least the dreams that I remember. And the sort of like example of like for sure next week I'll have a dream that I'm like in the Strand, like looking at books and thinking like, should I buy that? You know, like that sort of a thing. Or like a common enough dream for me is like in the dream I wake up and, you know, I think like, are we out of beans? And I go into the kitchen and we have some beans and I'm like, oh good, don't worry, we have beans. And that's the end of the dream. And the friends of mine were reporting like very wild dreams. My friend Mike, who's a writer, told me that he called me once and he said, I had an amazing dream last night. I said, what was it? He said, I dreamt that I had sex with a dragon. And I almost hung up on him. I was so angry, because that sounded so good. Like, how do you have sex with a dragon? But then when my older brother died, and for a short period of time after that, I had the most intense dreams about flies. And sometimes they were little, and sometimes they were like huge flies that would like wake me up and like get me dressed and things like that. And so some of these elegies came out of this. And this one is called Killing Flies. I sit down for dinner with my brother again. This is the last dream I ever want to have. Passing the forks around the table, passing the knives. One thing I want to know is who's in the kitchen right now, if it isn't me. It isn't me. The kitchen is full of flies. Flies are doing all the work. They light on the edge of the roasted chicken, the bone china. That's what they do, light. I will look more and more like him until I'm older than he is. Then he'll look more like me if I was lost. The flies need to be killed as soon as we're done eating this delicious meal they made. They serve us anything we want, in toxic tuxedos and shit wings. My brother and I wipe our mouths, scrape our chairs back from the table, and stand up. These are the last things we'll do together. Eat dinner. Kill flies. You have to lie down next to the bodies, shining all in a row like black sequins stitching up the kitchen floor. It's hard to do, but you have to do it. Quietly lie down and not sleep. We don't sleep. My brother and I work hard all night, sticking their eyes onto our earlobes and wrists like Egyptian jewelry. He is my emergency exit. I am his dinner date. And this poem is called Gardening because the, you know, rumors are that spring is here. I mean, who fucking cares? We've had such a hard winter. but gardening. I put my hands away. I take my hands and put them in the dirt for later. The endless maple leaves, all pointing down toward the grass and the dead dogs. What's buried there is hair and hearts. Then it's time to start. I dig up my hands so I can beat back the dogs. I beat them back into their hair, into their hearts, beating one after the other. I drop my eyes into a hole into the earth so I could see. Shovel, shovel. Don't you want to lie down with your hands on your stomach? Let's all do the worm. From this position, I can see the fine hair-like roots of the maple begin to begin. A lightning storm in the brain, in the green brainstem of the wet world. What do you think will receive us? The front yard? The backyard? Fingers and mouths? The calm green breast of your friend? There's nothing better in the world than belonging to the grass. I want to dig everything up and beat back the dogs inside me to make room for more dogs, more hearts, more hair, more teeth. There's always some little thing you've got to do.
I just read a couple new poems about animals.
I worked really hard when I was growing up to have a really shitty education. Even though a good one was offered to me, but I thought I would just drink or do skateboard and so as an adult I've I mentioned Homer, but I read the Odyssey last summer, and I recently discovered this poet who was writing the 1800s. He's a contemporary of John Keats, named John Clare. Do you all know him? Do you know Clare? And I was so taken by his poems about birds and animals. And in fact, the English poet Simon Armitage told me that he knows birders, if they're called birders, in the UK, who refer to Clare's poems as a field guide to find nests and things. And I thought, that is amazing. Like, a sonnet from the 1800s, and it's 2014, and someone's like, maybe there is the... So I started writing, because of him, these animal poems. This poem is called Foxtrot. Dear Fox, where have you been? Dead on the dance floor, in the middle of a field. Your natural weave frozen to the ground. Palm to palm, cheek to cheek, I want my arms around you. Your red hair bleached blue. Champagne drips from a butterfly onto a blade of grass. Well, it does. What ate your insides out? Out all night music whistles through a feather finish and your new permanent smile. You can't smell hay when it's this cold out. You can't smell shit. Dead fox, good morning. I have a headache in the ground. It won't come up. It won't flower. I do a feather hover above your broken ribs. Little icebergs of pain. Bales of hay pump out hot renditions of I can't get started with you. And night and day. You must be tired. Your hands curled up. Your eyes missing. A quick step won't save you now, Foxtrot, or reverse turn your spine back into a xylophone. Fast, fast, slow, slow. You look like you've been doing yoga in a freezer bag. Hunger pose between bird's eyes and Haagen-Dazs. Your teeth sparkle. I just have time to rent a tuxedo. A black waterfall. Do you mind if I lead? Inside your chest falls one flake of snow. Outside your chest, it gets darker earlier.
mouse hunt. Your little eyes, brake lights and gray fur, scrunched up beneath the house. Your huge balls and small hands. Your see-through babies still alive in the dirt blinking, those blind fruit jellies still alive. Your frozen nose searching for your brothers and sisters. I couldn't hit you with a hammer. Puffball, that little hiss you make. Oh look, you have a mother. Your whiskers in a storm, your pleasure center radio antenna checking the latest score, bumblebee marbles of shit. Your ears folded over like paper airplanes covered in birch bark flying through heavy fog. Your brain somewhere else altogether, singing late into the night in the kitchen under the ruined linoleum, chasing the cat through the comet. Your legs ride a bicycle in your sleep until you stop. Your family curled up in the corner, eating themselves in circles, your dreams rolled up inside the paper towels, perfect teeth, silver fillings, and expensive new crowns, your tumors dancing beneath the inverted black bowl of your crushed mulberry skull, dancing like jugs of milk, lighting the way between the bedroom and bath, your pure pink Pepto-Bismol on the bottoms of your feet, last thing every night before bed. And this last poem is called Dog Vertigo. Some teeth down there, some hair and gray gums, some grass and dirt down there, some gristle and whimpers, all stupid grinning death, running around the yard, making a little child cry from each busted grass blade. I had a dog. I had three dogs. I sit and stay. They did not disappear into the trees one day. Their brains were not broken coral on the street. They were meat, some grass and dirt down there, some teeth and ruined carpets. I had a dog. I had three dogs. I fucked fleas, all stupid grinning death, running around the yard, making a little child cry from each busted grass blade. Some eyelashes down there, some eating grass and mange, some baby's breath. One day, their brains were not broken, coral on the street, they did not disappear into the trees. Some sit and stay down there, some meat and sunlight. Their brains were not broken coral on the street, they did not disappear into the trees. They did not fuck fleas, all stupid grinning death, running around the yard, making a little child cry from each busted grass blade, some bones and baby's breath down there, some bark and seizures, distant watery eyes. One day I had a dog. I had three dogs. Thanks so much.
Thank you very much. I would like to read a few words that Philip Schultz actually wrote about Michael Dickman, and which I realize I should have read before, but when you are behind a podium, things happen. Heliosphere is the area around the sun that is influenced by its power and magic. Michael Dickman's poem owns such an aura of influence and inspiration. Each word is often an image whose music holds sway long after a first or second reading. Possessing the imaginations of those who read you is a remarkable gift, as you could see. Say thank you again. Now I would like to introduce Philip Schultz, Pulitzer Prize poet and director of the Writers' Studio. Philip Schultz is the author of several collections of poetry and one memoir, My Dyslexia, published by Northern, and tonight he will be reading from his new collection of poetry, The Wherewithal. And The Wherewithal is one of those rare books which speaks to many different kind of audience. First, it truly reads like a novel, a suspenseful novel, following many stories whose emotional power only deepens as they meet one another. But it's also a philosophical book, which has the courage to delve into what humans are capable of doing to each other and the consequences they pay for refusing to do so. Above all, it's a book for poetry lovers, displaying an incredible rhythmical, muscular, and compressed language in which every character's action is operating on a metaphorical level. In other words, the Wherewithal manages to make philosophy sing, and this is a very rare gift. Please welcome Philip Schultz.
Well, thank you all for being here. And thank you, Michael. Wonderful reading. I considered reading some new poems too, but then I realized that this book doesn't like company. I'm going to try to read some sections that make some narrative sense. This is the opening of the book. Upstairs at San Francisco, 1968, April 17th, and every day the world spins faster on its axis, a little more off kilter, a little less in its right mind, bursting at its seams with desire for variation, while everyone, everywhere around me, appears to be fornicating in doorways and on rooftops and spiraling parks under transplanted palms, beside rhododendron beds, marching and waving fists and wheels of sweltering air, hurrying in every direction, possessed of an overflowing innocence and furious resolve and revolutionary zeal. Indeed, hurling themselves against barricades of forlorn ideals and ancient decrees, throwing off rusty shadows and leafy, inane inner beings, singing unholy penitential psalms full of righteous sorrow, yes, forgiving nothing while remembering everything, while I, one Henryk Stanislav Wyrzykowski, head clerk of closed files, a department of one, work for the time being in a hole in the earth, hiding from the U.S. Army, from a vast personal history of defeat and occupation, of anger and despair, among other things. Work in a forgotten well of ghostly sighs, where, more often than not, it's Poland, 1941, June 25, and in the town of Jawabne, a great massacre is taking place, and the world has stopped in its tracks. He works in the basement of a welfare building. It's the 60s, 1968. 1 year younger than I, Rossi, a 17-year-old Polish-American Jew who never played chicken before, bought a .22 caliber rifle to shoot pigeons and a few confused rats in the old railroad yards on the outside of the dark inside of North Chicago, with a fake driver's license and a hubris first inspired and then deflated by me. Rossi, who lived eight houses down on the other side of a street filled with obsolete refugees and antique trees, wore patched chinos, white shirts with upturned collars, stuttered every third word, and ran with elbows aloft like chicken wings, because I did, stood glistening in a field of high grass, behind mounds of rusted tracks, joking around with me, while provoking, it seemed, an investigation into something that seemed to require a somewhat perverse curiosity and resigned belief in the intangible ecstasy of violence. 17, nonetheless, is old enough to understand that death isn't a game. But what was it then? Well, it was July, late morning, humid and slow, a cloudless, stagnant sky. No wind to speak of, not a wing to be seen. The beginning and end of any meaning I'd ever owned. Irony. Is irony the right word to describe how Mother's Alzheimer's erased the part of her life she wanted to remember and rendered vividly the part she wanted to forget? Is it in a character in the the narrator is a philosophy graduate student, or was until he left school, and he's studying Wittgenstein. Is it merely one of Ludwig's perverse paradoxes? In any case, every detail of Mother and I holding hands on a teak bench in a tiny park outside the ivory-covered brick building on the outskirts of Chicago a little over a year ago is limned in my memory. Even the women's names on the brass tree plaques, Mother's, I think, Beth, Mary, Beth, Dolores, her right hand beautifully fitted into my left, each of her knuckles and stamp-like fingertips achieving the same feeling of inevitability. Only yesterday, these fingers pushed hair from my eyes and pointed to the barn behind our house, and then beyond to the woods, knowing I'd know the signal being given. Her blue eyes focused inward as if no longer interested in the outside, as if having forgotten that their purpose was to recognize and name and memorialize and not erase. He's translating in this basement his mother's diaries, which deal with this massacre, this pogrom that took place in pogrom in Poland. And his mother is based on a real woman who was a great hero and saved the life of the only seven Jews who survived this massacre. Her diaries begin on July 10, 1941, the day the non-Jewish half of Yavabne's population attacked and murdered the Jewish half, and end on January 15, 1949, a year after she arrived in Chicago. Because I'm not a translator or scholar, and her lack of education and bad grammar requires clarification and notation, I chose not to correct or explain the unexplainable, wanting the astonishment of her own words. Numbered 7 to 22, 6 are missing. Hidden under her bedroom closet floorboards, number 7 begins. Who didn't know what was happening? My husband Andre knew. My son Henryk and daughter Christina were little, but they knew. Everybody knew. First the Russian monsters, then the Nazis. My eyes watched what my neighbors did to the Jews from the June day in 1941. She's a Catholic woman. When the Germans came and the pogrom started with the Borowski's brothers going door to door playing an accordion so no one would hear the screams. Who did they think would hear? God? Stoning with bricks, plucking old man Kroeski's eyes out, cutting off his tongue. Everyone pretending only the Germans did such things. Not us who sold them cows, tipped our hats, good morning. We wouldn't kill and torture people we knew since we were children. Why? Because they had better houses, clothes, shops, worked harder, had more faith, cheering an old man crying for mercy without a tongue. Sitting and clapping on the banks of the pond, a sweet young Chachka Kurbinsky and her best friend Bazinia Brzancha, whom I knew since they were infants, tried to drown their newborns rather than let them be ripped apart. Everyone laughing and giving advice on how best to drown an infant. My neighbors' mothers and fathers so proud of themselves. Imagine holding your newborn underwater, the strength and love it takes, the faith that God would love them now, and not a German in sight. He remembers the jobs he has in San Francisco before he took the job in the basement. He's hiding from the draft. Because 1As could be called up the next day, no one was hiring me. So I'd go to the docks, work maybe one day in six, and then try yellow, where Ruby, the epically obscene dispatcher, liked to ask why a long-haired, radical, fuck-faced shirker like me wasn't out killing gooks in Nam, goddammit. I got by on food stamps, stealing ribeyes from the IGA, a bizarre and noisy solitude, some 33 varieties of philosophical and sexual melancholy, not to mention being sequestered within a decade indelibly stained with curious appetites. I didn't own a TV, was too busy evading the U.S. Army to read newspapers, but I had seen the Zodiac's coded communiques and crazy cryptograms, bragging how much fun killing human beings was, that thus far his inventory included 4 men, 3 women, a cop, and maybe some 37 other innocents. So one cloudy Monday morning, after the night the maniac told the San Francisco Chronicle he'd kill a cabbie next, I showed up at Yellow Cab, knowing only that I was hungry. And looking around the empty locker room, I asked Ruby why he was finally hiring me. "Must be your lucky day, shithead," he said. Unlike Auschwitz or Birkenau, which endorsed the illusion of a workplace, Treblinka, a train platform and a one-way road to eternity, was a place, Rosie's father told Rossi, where illusion didn't exist. Just corpses burning all night on grills, greasing the sky with an effluvium medieval in its spite. Inspired perhaps by the unspent imagination of generations, where a lucky few survived by pulling precious gems from the teeth of the dead and cut and swept miles and miles of women's hair, which, as a history of brushings and intimate caresses, were stored faithfully in woven baskets in the survivors' dreams. At night, he covered with sand the body parts, which turned red in the morning light. Once or twice, a hand or foot twitched on the surface, indicating, perhaps, what the Dead Sea Scrolls prophesized, that the final war between those of heightened purity and those who walk in the wicked way had arrived. On a garage shelf under which, on a tiny army cot, the survivor slept, boxes were labeled. Rossi's black curls at 19 weeks, at 53 months, at year 8, etc. Hair cut over Rossi's protests, of course. The day after I killed his son, the fires of Treblinka were turned on me. Rossi couldn't pass his driver's test, return a library book, memorize anything. He took art classes when I became the high school cartoonist, bought 3 plaid shirts when I bought 1. And when I didn't let him tag along on my movie dates, he'd sit alone in the balcony 3 rows back, eating popcorn and weeping. And when I asked him to, he placed a soup can on his head and stood there, smiling at me. To try to imagine someone else's pain using your own as a model is misleading, Ludwig suggests. Such a transition isn't practical or even possible. possible. Perhaps this is why workers here are trained not to see the surrounding pain, to shut out all sensation and focus on the ever-flowering minutiae of the case at hand. Pain isn't a description of a mental state, but a signal or metaphor for sensation. Because, Ludwig says, the real subject of pain is the suffering that gives it expression. Is empathy, therefore, an illusion? Is there no grief but our own? Potentially, are we all monsters? Two weeks after driving a taxi for one night and 5 months before my job down here, Jiggers Malone, an ex-Marine under whose right eye an American Eagle tattoo drifted mostly north, hired me without asking my draft status, never a good sign, to fill vending machines on an aircraft carrier just back from the Gulf of Tonkin. No training, not a word about schooling, work experience. All he said was, fill the fuckers and get the hell out of the way. So five of us, none of whom appeared to want to be introduced or know why, guys who knew nothing about vending machines or aircraft carriers, were hired to do something this bizarre. Parked under a floating peninsula, helicopters tearing up the robust northern Californian sky, cranes swaying off the inflated vanity of the main deck, sailors running up and down gangplanks, dangling off scaffolds, scraping and painting the redoubtable bow of the USS Constellation, Connie to some, shouted Giggers, pushing me out of the way of a forklift. These guys get mean waiting on furloughs, beat the machines up good, insurance replaces three batches a month, but destroying machines ain't booze and pussy, if you know what I mean. 15 minutes to fill and repair the remains, kiddos. In what sort of context does it occur? Ludwig said the question was. In Treblinka, Rossi's father, the survivor, said there were bells, shots, meals, orders, and alarms, but no clocks. Strapped to your wrists, only an unbreakable code signifying infinity minus one. A context requires clocks, Ludwig would say. For something to occur, something needed to be lived in, approached, repelled by, consumed. The present, to exist, must be remembered, despised, and feared. In other words, the soup of the past must contain the vaguest memory of meat. In Treblinka, the survivor said, the future ended with the railroad tracks, promising nothing, remembering nothing, not even one's name. In Treblinka, he said, the sun was yet to be born. Though I treat my memories concerning mother cordially, somehow they seem to know I resent them and act as if they don't really care. Haughty, domineering, and full of spleen, they mix fantasy with hearsay, add pieces of my dreams and diced feelings to form a reality mostly devoid of me. At age 2, I went to our barn with mother to feed our Jews. A memory insists it can still smell their filthy clothes, the rot between their toes that they tried to wash off in the pig trough every other Tuesday. That I can see 5 adults, a teenage boy, and a girl no older than me, lying side by side in a hole as deep as a barn door, as wide is our horse stall. Insists it can see in the dawn's light their eyes startled out of sleep, gazing up into mine, then quickly looking away, as if to spare me the shame of their wretchedness. They understood, it insists, why I withdrew my hand as they reached for cups of milk, porridge, slices of bread, of black bread, never imagining how much I craved a portion of mother's love for them. Can I really smell the shit pot I emptied? Hear mother's screaming for me to run into the woods as fists broke her cheekbones? Because even they knew she wouldn't say where our Jews were hidden. Having smuggled something mysterious back and forth between the East Bay and San Francisco, my hand shook every time I tried to climb into a cab. So once again, I ended up in line waiting for food stamps for sustenance until I found part-time works teaching spelling one and arithmetic two to rich South Koreans and Saudi Arabians at Harold's Business School on Market Street, speaking very slowly. For a little over minimum wage, wearing an old Salvation Army tie and bruised asymmetrical jacket, a haircut provided by a cross-eyed ex-piano teacher I met in line, chin and cheek shaven while my split upper lip kept its hairy camouflage. But hey, suddenly I was igniting a blackboard with rules about what does and doesn't happen when I goes before E and 18 is extracted from 26 before being savaged by 3 after 6 is forsaken. Which was why I was up half the night reading basic manuals until the morning of the day I was asked to teach speech one and maybe two to soldiers irregularly stationed at the Presidio, 35 young glazed eyes staring at the floor or ceiling and very far out the windows at anything but where the skinny weirdo was struggling to explain a few simple principles about human discourse to those seriously suffering from a variety of mostly severe nervous disorders after enduring 22 straight months of utter hell. As the manual insisted, on week two, the pros and cons of splitting infinitives must be discussed, mentioning that to some grammarians it was acceptable, others not. To juice things up, I quoted the opening line from Star Trek, to boldly go where no man had gone before. Usually we get along, I fake enthusiasm and they interest. With 28 minutes to go and no one asleep, I, the object of polite indifference, needing to kill time, asked a bullish man in the front row what he thought of grammatical rules like this. His half-shut eyes enjoying a drug stupor, he slowly lifted his head, grunting, "What the fuck?" Everyone awake now. I backed into the blackboard, stuttering, "Well, what do you think? Split the fuckers?" Amid strained laughter, a soldier near me said, "Don't ask him that, or anything." Unable to find my tongue, I shut my mind as the man slowly rose toward an enormity I had never seen before. Finally, an apology for what? Squeaked out. Then, cheeks inflamed by blood, he shook the tremendous flat iron of his forehead, his eyes staring past me to the blackboard. Eclipsed, nobody looked at anybody else, an endless moment lurching toward solemnity. Off every wall, his voice echoed, "You ever kill a man?" My head tried to nod, but my mind wouldn't budge. "That's yes or no. Tell me. I want to know." "Yes, once, a long time ago." "Not much fun, eh?" I started crying. slow, easy, sputtering, rising into raw sobbing. Surprised, he walked over and wrapped me in his arms. Okay, man, I know. We're all just poor, sick animals. It's in our nature, not really our fault. Everyone rose simultaneously with the bells and walked out, leaving us there sobbing. Stepping back to look at me, he said, I killed 32 men, boys some. You'll never know what I've seen. And walking away, paused at the door to add, it's a solecism, but you knew that. Yes, I knew that. A few more. Some knew, the survivor said, where the trucks were taking them. Trucks full of women and children passing after a selection. In their eyes and slumped bodies, even the ones who didn't know, knew. The resignation of the men staring at the ground, not watching them pass once, twice, five times a day, knew. Wasn't it better for those who didn't know not to? Once he thought to cry out, but didn't. How ordinary it became, how routine. Worst in spring, when to the trees life returns, while in their souls winter remains. If he could pray, he prayed to the God of death, not depravity, desperation, or cruelty, but death. Who shall ascend the mountain of death? I will lift up mine eyes to death. The dead praise not the Lord, belly of the shadow of death, our Father, our King, death. Passing on their way to be burned and buried and dug up and buried again. Death already owned them. Creatures so unbearable, they must be destroyed three times, without anger, mercy, or acknowledgement, only death. Yet, their faces remain, too young and too old, too pretty and tired and sick, too lost and dreaming in the unknown, passing and passing into anonymity beyond which only time lives. Did it matter why they were so despised? Why not once did he or they cry out? Because they already knew. Everything had been lost. This is the last section. Yes, what we do with our lives, suffering is useful, even necessary and brilliant, especially when every sign seems dead. These last hours, he's on his way. He's going to go to Mexico. These last hours of work seem no longer mine. Here a short while and then gone. Some noisy moments of serenity, quiet triumph. Then once again, the silence of being somewhere in between. The blonde thug's words echo all the way from Port Chicago to down here. You know, I hire that accompaniment. The blonde thug's words echo all the way. I'll let it go. Actually, let me. This never happens in East Hampton. These last hours of work seem no longer mine. Here a short while and then gone. Some noisy moments of serenity, quiet triumph. Then once again the silence of being somewhere in between. The blonde thug's words echo all the way from Port Chicago to down here. Maybe you learned something. Yes, but what? A refrain as well as a dictum. What did and didn't occur and to whom? I know now that Mother is perhaps the happiest person alive. She didn't turn away, but stood there, eyes wide open, seeing everything. Her suffering was useful. It helped her stand up to her fear. I also didn't finally turn away. What I learned about myself is limited to what I know about human beings, that we're despicable and unworthy, and sometimes magnanimous enough to survive with dignity. The unspeakable things we do, the vicious lies we tell ourselves and others, the innocence we beat to death with and without shame, is always there in the smallest gesture of our eyes and hands and tongues. There in the only wealth and meaning we possess, the fragile filament of our humanity, which perhaps is what we envy and suspect and fear and want to kill in others. Without it, there is nothing but infinite black space, ripples on a lake, screams no one hears. Is this why we speak and listen, suffer grief and fear, and seek forgiveness even while living in a hole? Such stately and curious specimens, so many ghostly echoes. Goodbye, Henry Wyrzykowski, and all the still rising souls of Yevabne. Listen off the pitiless cinder block everywhere, the softest, tiniest echoing. The Yishkadash, the Yishkadash, it's the mourner. Got it. Thank you.